The Scioto River in Ohio was once a major waterway for a people who left their mark on the land by building great structures of earth. Embankments, ramparts, ditches, and mounds. Civil engineer James Marshall sees the mounds as proof their prehistoric Indian builders were highly skilled in mathematics and surveying. And Marshall is not the first to be impressed by the engineering skills revealed in these mounds. Over a century ago, these same earthworks were surveyed by two citizens of the nearby town of Chillicothe, Ohio. But Ephraim Squire and Edwin Davis saw the mounds not as proof of the skills of their Indian builders, but as proof instead that the Indians could not have built them. That the mounds were the work of a wondrous and tragically vanished civilization, a lost race. The mounds and the great geometric banks of earth have been changed by time. And so too have the stories white men have told about them. This film is about those stories and the questions they've tried to answer. Who built the mounds? How? And why? The stories began in the late 1700s, when white settlers pushing down the Ohio River came across mounds and earthworks like these at Marietta. Everywhere in the valley of the Ohio were immense brooding mounds and rings and lines of earthworks. To farmers, the mounds were simply a nuisance. But others saw the mounds as miraculous proof that North America's prehistory was as rich as the Old World's and Central and South America's. Who had labored to build such astonishing works? Surely not the few surly and clearly uncivilized Indians who then lived in the area. But almost anyone else was a candidate. Harvard University's Ian Brown.
They were attributed to Vikings, the Welsh, the lost tribes of Israel. You name it, every group had some sort of responsibility for the construction of the mounds, except the Indians.
By the early 1800s, the popular imagination was seized by the idea that America had once been peopled by a race of supermen, or at least of white men, or at least of people who built the mounds as they passed through North America on their way to founding the great civilizations of Mexico. Learned gentlemen began excavating mounds, finding in them ornate artifacts of stone, pottery, and copper, and the remains of the mound builders themselves. It was skulls excavated from mounds in Tennessee and Mississippi that in the 1830s became the object of the first scientific attempt to answer the question, who were the mound builders? Dr. Samuel Morton of Philadelphia was devising ways to measure skulls. Filling a skull with mustard seeds was the first step in the most important measurement, skull volume. Morton's goal was to use skull measurements to reveal the differences between races. But his comparison of mound builder skulls with those of modern Indians showed them to be almost identical. The only conclusion was that mound builders and Indians were the same race. Perhaps embarrassed by this finding, Morton devised two major tribes within this single race. The mound builders belonged to one of these tribes, along with the people who created the high civilizations of Mexico. And the modern North American Indian belonged to the other tribe, which Morton called barbarous. So he managed to fit his facts to the popular view that the mound builders were not the ancestors of the modern Indians, who were clearly uncivilized savages. Morton's conclusions, published in his book Crania Americana, also accommodated the idea that it was the barbarous Indians who wiped out the noble mound builders. An increasingly popular view, distilled in a mid-19th century poem by William Cullen Bryant.
As all the verdant waste I guide my steed, the hollow beating of his footsteps seems a sacrilegious sound. I think of those upon whose rest he tramples. Are they here, the dead of other days? Let the mighty mounds that overlook the river, or that rise in the dim forest crowded with old oaks, answer. A race that long has passed away built them. A disciplined and populous race heaped with long toil the earth, while yet the Greek was rearing on its rock the glittering Parthenon. The red man came, the roaming hunter tribes, warlike and fierce, and the mound builders vanished from the earth. The solitude of centuries untold has settled where they dwelt. All is gone, all save the piles of earth that hold their bones, the platforms where they worshipped unknown gods, the barriers which they builded from the soil to keep the foe at bay. One by one, the strongholds of the plain were heaped with corpses. The brown vultures of the wood flocked to those vast, uncovered sepulchres and sat, unscared and silent, at their feast.
What was the appeal of the idea that the mounds were built by a lost race? The Smithsonian Institution's Bruce Smith.
It was a very romantic and a very dramatic explanation for it, and it was also an explanation that sort of left out the Indian groups that existed in North America when the first Europeans arrived. And if you leave out these indigenous Indian populations as having anything to do with these mysterious mounds of the past, you get a very awkward problem that faced the whites that occupied the eastern United States. If you connected these mounds with the Indian groups that existed in the eastern United States, this would demonstrate that these Indians had a relatively high level of cultural development, which would have strengthened their claim of ownership to the lands that they were being driven out of.
It is no coincidence that the mound builder myth became more popular during the time when Indian tribes like the Cherokee and Choctaw were winding their way along the Trail of Tears from their homelands in Mississippi, Alabama, and Georgia to the territories west of the Mississippi, at the point of the white man's gun. Ohio, to the north, had been largely abandoned by its native peoples before white settlement began. In the mid-1840s, two prominent citizens of the town of Chillicothe set out to make an extensive survey of the mounds and earthworks that crowded the Scioto River Valley. Ephraim Squire, editor of the Chillicothe Gazette, and Edwin Davis, local physician, were impatient with the more outrageous mound builder myths. Not for them stories of biblical tribes or Hindu empires. Instead, they planned to simply record and classify what they found.
From your description in my own brief visit, the earthwork would seem to be a ceremonial enclosure, not a work of defense.
Well, there's certainly no outer ditch present, and the earthwork is low in several openings.
And the mounds themselves, altar mounds, do you suppose?
I believe it would repay us sinking some shafts on a later occasion.
Squire and Davis did some excavation, but as on this embankment at a site called Mound City, spent most of their time mapping and surveying. Their surveying was meticulous, but their classification of mounds and earthworks came more from their imagination than from their measurements.
North, 20 degrees northwest.
Their idea that some embankments were defensive ramparts, for instance, owed more to Squire and Davis's belief that the mound builders had come under savage attack than it did to the nature of the earthworks themselves. But one thing above all impressed Squire and Davis as they struggled through thickets and clambered over earthworks in their pursuit of the mound builders: the sheer scope and scale of the mound builders' achievement. To Squire and Davis, it was inconceivable that Indians could have done such work. Instead, they favored one of the more conservative of the theories as to who the mound builders were: people who passed through North America, perfecting their skills as they went, before finally settling in Mexico and founding the empires of the Toltecs and Aztecs. But more valuable than Squire and Davis's ideas were the records they kept and the maps they made. These maps became a priceless record of the mound builders' astonishing achievements, for even by the 1840s, the earthworks were rapidly disappearing beneath the farmer's plow. Meanwhile, the mounds themselves were being looted for the artifacts that were buried along with the mound builders' dead. Artifacts like these exquisite stone pipes, carved in a style much more suited to white Victorian tastes than the carvings of contemporary Indians, again confirming the mound builders' superiority. By the 1860s, white pioneers were battling the Plains Indians of the West. So stereotyped became all Indians that even distinguished scholars could write of the Indian:
his character is signalized by treachery and cruelty. He was never known to engage in an enterprise requiring methodical labor. To suppose that such a race threw up the mounds is as preposterous almost as to suppose that they built the pyramids of Egypt.
Yet, in fact, evidence that Indians had built and used mounds had been available for over 200 years. Early Spanish and French explorers of the Mississippi Valley described Indians living in settled agricultural villages with an elaborate social system of chiefs and commoners who buried their distinguished dead in earthen mounds and whose leaders lived atop great platforms of earth. Like this one, center of the Natchez Indians, and well known to early Spanish and French explorers. Ian Brown.
They described the structures that were being used by the Natchez as being built on top of Indian mounds, similar to the ones that we have right here. There would have been a chief's house on one of the mounds and a temple on the other, and perhaps some smaller houses of some ceremonial importance on the smaller mounds surrounding it.
These descriptions included the fact that the Indians had a well-developed agriculture based on corn, beans, and squash. It was a picture of Indian life strikingly at odds with the mid-19th century image of the Indian as an unsettled, uncivilized savage, incapable of organizing the sort of coordinated group effort mound building requires.
But here was the classic example of a mound in use by historic peoples that was severely neglected in later studies of the mound builders.
In 1879, the U.S. Congress appropriated $5,000 to solve the mound builder mystery once. Once and for all, Cyrus Thomas, a man long intrigued by the mounds, was given the job. Thomas spent most of his time in Washington, but sometimes went to check for himself on the work of his field assistants, like Gerard Falk. Falk's excavations, like those of the other field assistants, had to be done in strict accordance with Thomas's instructions, and Thomas was a stern and demanding authority.
And try to keep the walls straight.
Thomas himself was initially inclined to the lost race theory of the mounds, and was well aware of its seductive appeal.
The thought that once a mighty nation occupied the valley of the Mississippi, with its frontier settlements resting on the lake shores, and Gulf Coast, nestling in the valleys of the Appalachian Range and skirting the broad plains of the West. A nation with its systems of government and religion, but which has disappeared, leaving behind it no evidences of its glory, power, and extent, save these silent, forest-covered remains, as something so fascinating and attractive in it that once it has taken possession of the mind, it warps and biases all its investigations and conclusions. There seems to pervade the minds of many explorers, and in fact some American archaeologists, no doubt under the spur of this enchanting thought, the hope and expectation that some great and astounding find will yet be made which will confirm this theory.
Mr. Falk!
Yet the finds made by Thomas's army of field assistants confirmed instead that the theory owed more to wishful thinking than to the facts. In Tennessee, Falk unearthed in the center of several mounds stone slabs placed to form a coffin. These stone box graves were to be crucial in convincing Thomas that the mounds had been built by the ancestors of the Indians.
He's here. Look sharp, everyone.
But Thomas did not rely solely on the excavations of his field assistants. He also paid attention to the historical evidence that had been for so long ignored.
Good morning, Dr. Thomas.
Morning, Mr. Powell.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Good to see you.
Yes.
Thomas began establishing links between historical accounts of Indian societies and the discoveries being made in mounds. Here's the grave, stone box graves especially intrigued him.
Very slowly, very gently, lift the lid.
Thomas knew that here was a direct link between mounds and a living Indian tribe, the Shawnee.
Does it not seem odd to you, Mr. Falk, that although it is known that the Shawnee Indians built stone box graves like this, few amongst our colleagues would argue that they were mound builders?
It's very true, sir.
For Thomas, the evidence overcame the emotional pull of the mound builder myth. His discoveries needed no lost tribes or fabulous civilizations to explain them. Instead, the truth seemed both more mundane and, for what it implied about the Indian, more extraordinary.
The most important question to be settled is, were the mounds built by the Indians? There would then be no more blind groping by archaeologists for the thread to lead them out of the mysterious labyrinth. The chain which links together the historic and prehistoric ages of our continent would be complete. And the thousand and one wild theories and romances would be permanently disposed of.
Thomas also saw the danger of lumping together as one people everyone who had ever built mounds.
The term mound builders, although adopted from necessity, is an unfortunate one, as its constant use has accustomed the mind to look upon the authors of these ancient works as one people, thus fixing in the mind an unproven theory.
So Thomas not only laid finally to rest the romantic dream of a lost race of mound builders, he also allowed archaeologists to look at mounds in a new way, no longer as the work of one prodigious people, but as monuments of perhaps many different Indian cultures and times. Thomas produced a map of all the known mounds and earthworks, numbering over 10,000, and warned they were rapidly disappearing beneath farms and cities. As the pace of destruction accelerated, some of the largest mounds were hacked down and carted away to make way for the city of St. Louis. But now archaeology was also picking up its pace, and Thomas's recognition that all mound builders were not the same was confirmed as archaeologists realized they were dealing with two major mound-building cultures. One of these cultures was responsible for linear earthworks and largely conical mounds, mounds that almost always contained burials. Centered in Ohio and Illinois, this is called the Hopewell culture by archaeologists and flourished around the time of Christ. The second major mound-building culture constructed much larger mounds, often square or rectangular in outline and with flat tops. These mounds were used not as monuments to the dead, but as platforms for the living, supporting temples and the houses of the chiefs. The most spectacular platform mound, still standing, towers 100 feet over the flat landscape east of St. Louis. These platform mounds, dating to around 1,000 years ago, are centered on the lower Mississippi Valley and were built by a culture archaeologists call Mississippian. The rest of this film will look at these two mound-building cultures, the Mississippian of 1,000 years ago and the Hopewell of 1,000 years earlier, through the eyes of today's archaeologists. This is the valley of the Illinois River, just above its junction with the Mississippi. It is a region today of small farms, largely bypassed by 20th century America. But 2,000 years ago, it was one of the richest neighborhoods on the continent, an area peopled by Hopewell mound builders. For the past 22 years, centered on the small river town of Campsville, a research program aimed at understanding how these mound builders lived has been run by Northwestern University archaeologist Stuart Strever.
Campsville was a major river port back in the 19th century, all the way up till about 1920. When I came here 22 years ago, it was an abandoned town almost, and we've taken over 39 buildings, made it into a permanent archaeological research and teaching center. And it's an ideal place because you can bring scholars and students together away from the madhouse of the everyday urban world.
It was a very good thing for us because it was certainly a low overhead research facility. It cost us very little, and it's the most improbable research center you can imagine. We're going down the main street of the Campsville Center now, and on our left over here, you'll see what used to be the old meat market. That's our little museum where we show people what it is we're finding. And over here on the right was a sheltered care building. Old folks used to be there, and now today, it is a human osteology lab. Here on the right was the post office in Campsville. That's now our junior high field school lab. And then there's the drugstore. That's also a lab. Mr. Hank had his funeral home in that building, and it's now our archaeological research library.
The Campsville program derives much of its support from contract archaeology associated with federal construction projects, such as this new interstate that will shortly slice across the Illinois Valley and destroy sites occupied by mound builders on this bluff and riverbank. Administering the program to dig the sites before the road arrives is Ken Farnsworth.
The road will be built across the floodplain behind us, coming out of the bluffs about 4 miles distant and extending just to the right of those buildings in the middle of the floodplain. It will come across here, extend into these bluffs here, and hit right about where we're standing. This is the centerline marker right here.
One major excavation is concentrating on a group of burial mounds directly in the path of the road. In charge of this part of the program is Northwestern University's Jane Bykstra.
Here we've walked into the middle of a 2,000-year-old mound. What we have here is a trench that we've excavated, expanding upon a trench that was dug about 50 years ago by parties unknown who would have been looking for artifacts deep within the mound.
For instance, this is an example of a type of object we might expect to find with those individuals buried in the center of the mound. It's a Hopewell bowl, dates to about 150 AD, and as you can see is a very finely crafted item, typical of the kinds of things, the pipes and the points and so forth, we might find in the central part of the mound.
Buried with the honored dead of the Hopewell people was an extraordinary variety of artifacts, distinguished not only by their beauty, but also by the diversity of the materials used to make them. Copper, as in these ear spools, from the Great Lakes. Pearls and shells from the Gulf Coast. Mica sheets from North Carolina. And from as far away as the Rocky Mountains, obsidian. So striking are these artifacts and the extensive trading network they suggest that until recently, archaeologists regarded all Hopewell people as a single culture.
It was simply an error of the way archaeologists worked. They wanted to find artifacts, and the way to find them was to dig a hole right down in the middle of the mounds. And if you dug there, you found these beautiful artifacts, and the ones in Ohio, and the ones in New York, and the ones in Kansas looked alike, and therefore it must be one people. Just as if you dug an icebox up in Saudi Arabia, you dug one up in Chicago, it must be one culture, right?
Today, archaeologists are interested less in artifacts than in the people who made them, in trying to learn from the mounds and their contents how and why they were made. For instance, how much of society's resources did mound building take?
I don't think we need to think of the mound building as having disrupted the total life of the community for a long period of time. On the other hand, these are big mounds. And it's a question, you know, how long did it take?
To find out how long it takes to build a mound and the sort of organization mound building requires, the Campsville archaeologists set about constructing a mound for this film. Mound building begins with digging a pit. This would have formed the central tomb for the burial itself. The mound will be built over this tomb. As for what happens next, this is revealed in the internal structure of an excavated mound.
We have here the 2,000-year-old surface. It's capped by a thin, prepared surface of soil that the Indians brought here before they began to deposit basket loads of soil. You see the outline of one of these basket loads here. There's another good example here. And there's others that stand out on this wall.
Put it in, like after where it's cleared here. And out about this far.
So the next step is to lay down a thin ground covering of light-colored earth. This apparently formed a circular earthen floor all around the central tomb.
You can also start putting the backfill here, too.
Now, anybody that's got flat shoes can go and stamp on it a while.
You can tramp it first?
We're working on it, bud.
Labor to build the Odyssey Mound comes from a high school group visiting the Campsville Archaeology Center. Preparation of the burial tomb continues by lining it with dried reeds. The experiment in mound building includes a plan to bury in the mound some of the materials the mound builders of 2,000 years ago might have interred along with the dead. These materials include leather patches, whose size and shape are recorded before burial. The Campsville archaeologists plan to leave the materials within the mound for at least 5 years and perhaps as long as 50, periodically checking to see how long the different materials survive their burial. The tomb itself is roofed with logs. For the Hopewell people of 2,000 years ago, such a burial in the central tomb of a mound accompanied by exotic artifacts would have been reserved for only the most honored of their society. People of lower status were buried around the periphery of the mound, and others were placed in the earth forming the mound itself. A mat of woven reeds and a roof of limestone slabs completes the central tomb. And the stage is set for the mound building to begin.
What we're going to be doing is two different kinds of loading of dirt, and we're going to have three different kinds of soil. One group on this side of the mound will have, I want you to just throw the dirt like this so it spreads out in a nice flat layer. And the people on the other side are going to take the dirt and dump it just like this so you get a nice, neat little pile. Because at least those two kinds of loading techniques we've uncovered in mounds that we find now, where they just dump stuff and where they just kind of flung stuff. So we're going to try to simulate that.
Our mound building was given a head start by having the different soils already dug and ready for loading into the sort of baskets the original mound builders might have used.
Okay, we need spreaders over there and dumpers over here, okay?
The baskets were emptied to create the same soil patterns found in genuine mounds. The dirt piles were each about 150 feet away from the mound. We wanted to see how big a mound our volunteer labor could build in an afternoon's work. But to find out something of how the mound builders of 2,000 years ago managed to sustain organized group labor projects like this involves looking beyond the task of mound building itself to the way the people live their everyday lives. This means excavating the sites of their villages.
Well, the only thing I can think of is that...
This site, soon to be the footing of the interstate bridge, was once the floor of a circular house built of wood and probably thatched with reeds. The major posts that supported the house stood in holes packed with chinks of limestone rock. This limestone chinking is now all that remains of the house. But there are other clues left in the earth. Mike Wyant.
The house itself is constructed very near the prehistoric riverbank. Right now I'm walking up over the crest of the levee and down into an area of the site which we'll excavate next. This dark layer of soil represents a trash dump in which they were walking up to the edge of the riverbank itself and dumping the material down the face of it, presumably to use the river as the remover of the trash.
The Illinois River is still used today to help get rid of unwanted material from the site. In this case, the soil that accompanied the debris of everyday life 2,000 years ago. The scraps of trash are then dipped in a chemical bath. The lighter material floats and can be skimmed off. It contains burned and charred plant remains. The heavier debris is largely gravel, with some tiny pieces of pottery, and the remains of some of the animals the people ate. A fish scale, bones of wild fowl, deer, squirrel, raccoons. Among the commonest plant remains are nutshells, like this fragment of walnut. Nuts were important in the Hopewell people's diet, and have an important role, too, in giving high school students of today some insights into the hunter-gatherer way of life. The educational program at Campsville features the work of a man who is himself part Indian and who was raised by his Cherokee aunt in the ways of her people, John White.
One thing that I don't want to hear anybody saying is, geez, oh, this is too tough, man. I could never be an Indian. Because by saying that, you're kind of removing yourself from it a little bit. If you... You said, geez, I never could have been a white person. You know, it would sound a little bizarre. Or if you said, God, it was too tough, I could have never been a black. The point is, most of the things that we're going to be doing, most of the things that we're going to be seeing, are activities that with very minor variations here and there, to dovetail it to a particular resource, a particular part of the environment, everybody's people did. This is a technological breakthrough. This is a mortar and pestle. It's made with burning and scraping. And I've made what essentially is a very coarse meal. Okay, I can see people saying, yet. Is he actually going to eat that? Or maybe even more grossly, is he going to pick someone from the audience to have eat that? Okay, what I'd like to say is that the nearest equivalent in our culture today is coffee. Okay, you don't assume that anyone is going to eat the coffee grounds. What you do is you boil them up. When you get what you're going to get out of them, you strain it off. Okay, this is the raw material for soup.
White's son, Mark, a trained blacksmith, demonstrates how 2,000 years ago, Hopewell people worked copper. In this case, into a thin rod that will become one of the most important food-gathering tools Hopewell people possessed. Meanwhile, John White is showing his youngest son, Waddy, how to make another part of the toolkit.
See these? This is the fibers that are inside the skin of the plant. And that's what we're going to use for the fishing line.
to go with the fish hook that Mark's making. When we go and roll them like this, watch with that. You see that? Just twist right it. See? Strong.
With a gourd as a float to complete the fishing tackle, White and his sons fish one of the backwater lakes that are abundant in the Illinois and Mississippi River valleys, and which provided the mound builders with much of their food, waterfowl as well as fish. In the late summer, many of these backwater lakes dry up, and there is no need even for a fishing line. The diminishing pools trap thousands of fish and would have provided the Hopewell people with an abundant and easily gathered harvest. The Illinois River forms the main artery of an immensely rich ecological zone. A husband and wife team of botanists, David and Nancy Ash, are intrigued especially by the seed plants that grow along the shoreline of the river. Today they are visiting an island to check on a plant which grows well in the sandy soil of the river's edge.
David, there's some over here.
Called chenopodium, or goosefoot, it yields an abundance of small black seeds that can be ground into flour.
The seeds are starting to ripen. See?
Another plant, iva, or sumpweed, also grows in wild stands along the valley floor. On expeditions like this, the ashes can collect several pounds of seeds an hour. Sumpweed seeds are almost as unappetizing as their name, but the ashes have found that removing the husks and boiling the seeds makes them palatable. And they are very nutritious, rich in proteins, fat, and minerals. One of the most remarkable discoveries made by the ashes comes from an examination of the plant debris found in archaeological sites. The material is sifted to reveal the seeds it contains. Sumpweed seeds from a period earlier than the Hopewell mound-building culture are small, about the same as today's. But Hopewell period seeds are 2 to 3 times larger. The only explanation is that people were selecting larger seeds to plant. This is a revolutionary idea, for it suggests the Hopewell people, in effect, invented an agriculture based on the cultivation and selection of the wild plants in their environment. This would have greatly increased the land's productivity and the number of people it could support.
It begins to look like the valley was actually populated extensively enough to have it divided off into permanent subsistence territories where people would gather their plants and their animal foods. Approximately 10 miles of river frontage, say, to each stable group, with a base village and a mortuary cemetery mound group associated and various extractive camps in the environment. Probably 50 people per mile of river frontage 2,000 years ago here. And I must say that for this county, present day has less people living in it than it did 2,000 years ago. It was a very rich natural zone.
And in that kind of environment, they got productivities equivalent to agricultural productivities. And in that kind of environment, most people could be released much of the time for any activity that man deemed important, such as mound building.
So the richness of the Hopewell environment, especially when enhanced by a simple agriculture, helps explain how its people could have built their mounds. Meanwhile, in our mound-building experiment, it was becoming obvious that even without the incentive of participating in an important ritual event, mound-builders can assemble a good average-sized burial mound in a short afternoon's work, and with relatively few basket loads of earth.
300 for the scatter. And then how many do you have for loading?
I have 309.
Okay, so that made a total of 609 baskets within 3 hours' time, with 21 students and 4 adults, and then 10 old fogies.
It's confirmed our notion that it didn't take a great deal of labor, really, to build a mound of this size, and that's a significant size mound, actually. And it fits in with our notion that, you know, mound building was significant. It took a number of people over an afternoon. But on the other hand, it certainly wouldn't have disrupted a village's activities over several days or several weeks.
This mound, probably the first to be built on these bluffs in at least 1,000 years, may one day be useful to archaeologists of the future. Meanwhile, the remains of the original mound builders, here rescued from the advancing road building equipment by Jane Bykstra and her colleagues, can also yield unique insights into how the mound builders lived and died.
We can discover how old the individuals were, how long they were living. This individual, for instance, is a relatively old female, probably in advance of 50 years of age when she died.
An estimate of the height of the Hopewell people comes from the length of the long bones in their legs and arms.
We think that the females from about 2,000 years ago were between about 4'10" and 5'6". Males were taller. The range generally is between 5'1" and 6'. They could disappear nicely into a crowd in most of our major cities. They suffered from a variety of illnesses. This is a healed fracture. The individual suffered a broken bone. The fracture was not set. And here you see the result. The bone is healed, but of course there's a misalignment of the bone. And it's probably led in this individual to arthritis here in the elbow joint. You can also tell something about infectious pathology. We have, for example, here a heavily diseased skull. Some of the pits here go all the way through the skull into the brain and probably led to a brain infection and caused the individual's death.
In general, however, Hopewell people seem to have been reasonably healthy. But then came a change. This change can be followed at another excavation that is racing the construction of a road, this time a major bypass around East St. Louis. This site is important because people lived here during the time when the elaborate mound burials that characterized the Hopewell period gradually ceased. And in the remains of homes dating to around 700 and 800 AD, immediately after the Hopewell period, can be found what may have been the cause of the change, the most important new resource ever introduced into prehistoric North America, corn. Corn, or maize, was an import from Central America. It gives to the people who plant it and harvest it, like these Choctaw Indians today, the ability to take dramatically more from the land than nature untended provides. To the mound-building people of Hopewell times, it brought about irreversible changes. The old patterns of integration with nature were broken. The people spread out from the river valleys to the flat tops of the surrounding hills, planting corn among the woodlands, just as farmers still do today. The increased productivity probably brought about increased populations, but that was not the only change.
Dental health also changed during the shift to maize agriculture. You see here the mandible, the lower jaw of an individual who is from the period 2,000 years ago, the middle woodland period, before they began to cultivate maize. Prominent here is the degree of wear. There's very heavy wear. But otherwise, the teeth are healthy. There aren't cavities. There's no sign of inflammation. You can contrast that condition with that displayed here in a maize agriculturalist, an individual from about 1,000 years ago. There's very little wear on the teeth, but there's strong evidence for cavities in the teeth already in this fairly young adult. So clearly there is a change in dental health during this shift toward the maize agriculture.
The shift also seemed to decrease the amount of protein the people ate and caused an increase in diseases like tuberculosis, here revealed in a collapsed and fused spinal column.
The main reason that there was TB during this agricultural period is that there were more folks on the landscape. You had larger aggregates of individuals. And again, in terms of the whole adaptation domains, you have to view it, I think, as a biological compromise. You are supporting more folks on the landscape, but you're learning to live with this new resource base, and you're sacrificing during this period of change.
The change associated with the introduction of corn agriculture also saw the end of the Hopewell period of elaborate and exotic artifacts. From about 600 to 900 AD, the adaptation to maize seems to have consumed all the creative efforts of the people. The Hopewell artifacts fade from the archaeological record, to be replaced, as the lessons of corn agriculture were learned, by a new and spectacular phase of mound building.
This is Monk's Mound. It's the largest prehistoric man-made structure north of Mexico. Covers about 14 to 16 acres, and it contains about 22 million cubic feet of dirt.
Monk's Mound is the largest in a group of mounds at Cahokia, east of St. Louis. It was probably built over a period of 200 years, between about 900 and 1100 AD. It is the most spectacular structure remaining from the second great mound building culture, the Mississippian. It was a platform mound, its top the focus of Mississippian society. Bruce Smith.
We're about 140 feet above the Cahokia site now, on the top of Monk's Mound, and this was the center of the administrative and religious activities at the site. Off to the east here, you can see the recreation of a stockade line that appears to have gone around the central core area of Cahokia. It appears from the massiveness of the posts that were used in the stockade construction that it may have been used for defensive purposes. It may also, however, have functioned primarily to restrict access from the central ceremonial area. Up on the top of the mound here is where the chiefly elite would have lived. This is where most of the economic decisions, political decisions, and religious ceremonies would have taken place.
The ruling elite who lived on Monk's Mound controlled a population in the surrounding area of perhaps 50,000 people, some 5 or 10,000 of whom may have lived at Cahokia itself. Certainly it rivaled the large European cities of its day, and its rulers shared similar problems.
Within any of these Mississippian societies, the chiefly elite would have had the ever-present problem of how to keep the rest of the population in line, how to make sure that they towed the line and that they did not cause problems for the chiefly elite. They developed a number of different strategies to solve this problem, one of which was a series probably of almost continual group labor projects to continually remind the everyday people of the societies that they were under the thumb of the chiefly elite. The Mississippian elite also set themselves apart from the everyday population in visual ways that would constantly remind people that looked at them that they were a separate segment of the society. These are some ear spools. They probably had a copper covering on them when they were being used. It would have been worn in the ears of a high-status individual like this and would have been very visible to anyone in close proximity to the person. This is another symbol of high office or status within a Mississippian society. This is a monolithic axe. It's made from a single piece of greenstone. Probably was never actually used as an axe, but was a ceremonial representation of the status of the individual. This one was found right here at the Shiloh site. This is a ceremonial pipe with the bowl for the smoking material in the individual's back, and then a long wooden stem would have come out of this hole. It's probably restricted in usage to high-status individuals in the society. It was recovered with a high-status burial from one of the mounds here.
So the elaborate status objects of Mississippian society, along with the immense platform mounds and the labor they consumed, all helped preserve the status of the elite. But what did the people receive in return? Again, the answer of today's archaeology involves corn. Unlike the hunting and gathering, or even the simple agriculture of the earlier mound builders, the maize agriculture of the Mississippians required coordination and supervision. When to plant, what to plant, when to harvest. This information came from the elite, who in return skimmed off a portion of the crop for their own use, and perhaps for storage against hard times. The system worked well when things went well. But in the event of prolonged harvest failures, the people would see only too clearly who was to blame.
The chief was the one that would have been depended upon to maintain this maize, harvesting of maize and using it as a dependable food source. So if the maize stops coming in as a dependable food source, the status and the control of the chief would have been reduced.
Is this what happened to the greatest of the mound builders? Construction of the huge platform mounds peaked in the 12th and 13th centuries. By the time the first Spanish explorers arrived in the 1500s, Mississippian culture was already in decline. European diseases introduced by these explorers probably accelerated the collapse. The Natchez were the last of the great mound builders, until they were broken and scattered by the French in the early 1700s, and the myths of the mound builders began to stir. The racism inherent in these myths, which sought to deny the Indian his heritage, was part of the age in which the myths were invented. But to today's Indians, like the Choctaw, to whom this mound is sacred, archaeology is still suspect. Tribal counselor Ken York.
Archaeology is an invention of the white man. They have always tried to disprove something that this country has in lieu of a European concept, and that it's not possible unless the Europeans thought of it. And my belief always is that the Indian people had the same kind of technology and wisdom and knowledge just like any other people.
The awesome accomplishments of the people who built the mounds is strikingly shown here at Newark, Ohio, where 2,000 years ago, the Hopewell people built this great earthen circle and adjoining octagon. Why? No one knows. But revealed in the structures is a degree of mathematical sophistication which had escaped attention until they were studied by civil engineer James Marshall.
I was most amazed at what I saw here when I first came here in 1965. It was most amazing that nobody really saw... No one had seen these works in this light. It would be very difficult for the typical American man in the street, unless he had an engineering background, it would be very difficult for him to lay out these earthworks as precisely as Hopewell people did. I hope to shake up everybody with this, because we have been a very racist society. You see, that we have not really given the American Indian credit for even being able to count his fingers and toes.
So James Marshall also believes that the prejudices against the Indian that created the mound builder myths linger on, still denying the Indian his true achievements. Most archaeologists would not agree, arguing instead that they are illuminating the great Indian cultures of the past. But archaeology cannot divorce itself from its own culture.
There's always been an interest on the part of individuals, scientists and laymen alike, to explain why these mounds are here, why this kind of society first came into existence. It's something that can't be explained. So it's natural for people to want to fill this gap in their understanding of the world. Scientists are no less subject to this need for attempting to explain something. The sort of explanatory frameworks all along have been stories, basically. And the explanatory frameworks that archaeologists have in 1980 are stories or models of development that satisfy us today, simply because they're up to date in terms of terminology, they're up to date in terms of the models that are being used in the other social scientists. But we really don't know what happened.
For most Indians, the great heritage left by the mound builders long ago vanished from their own oral traditions. But in a few cases, the Choctaw and Cherokee included, tiny fragments, perhaps with no more truth than the myths of white men, linger on in the smoke and the magic of the campfire.
Now they fixed up a place for them.
John White tells a Cherokee story of a people who once came to live with his tribe. a people who had power over the sun.
They had earthen walls around it. That was where they lived. And they had a long mound of earth, big one. And every morning when the sun comes up, all of them are out there. They line up facing the east where the sun comes up. And the minute the sun's disk starts to peak above the edge of the earth, they all have their hands out like that. They're shaking them. And they're saying, hey, 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 hey. They keep doing this. All the while, the sun's coming up at the point that what they say, the sun breaks free of the earth and moves into the skyland. They got their hands up like that in the air. Then, as soon as it's up, they all whoop, hoop at it. They're glad they helped it break loose. They helped it come up. How old is that story? We don't know. But it's been handed down from generation to generation. And it survived. A slender thread connecting us with those ancient times. Up to today. Up to tonight. I want to thank all of you for your efforts today in helping to make some small part of the culture of the ancient people come back to life. Wada. Aneginale'e, my friends, wada. Thank you very much. Now, Cherokee people, don't say goodbye. In my lineage, you say, stayu, stayu. It means be strong. To each and every one of you here tonight, I say to you, stayu.
Major funding for Odyssey was provided by the National Endowment for the Humanities. Additional funding was provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and the Polaroid Corporation.